Thank you for attending the freelancing panel here at WordCamp Boston 2017. We're very excited to be here, and we're hoping that we can provide a lot of value to freelancers out there, or those running an agency, or are thinking about providing services to clients that relate to WordPress in some way. We're very excited to help you. My name is Kyle. We're going to do some introductions real quick, and then we're going to try and walk through a few frequently asked questions and broach a few topics that are very important that most of us encounter and deal with as a part of running our small businesses. And then we're going to take a lot of your questions. Okay, so listen to the introductions. We'll cover a few popular topics and prepare your questions as well, because we want to get to those. We're going to try and move as quick as we can. Panels often go long, especially on broad topics like this, so we're going to do the best we can. Adam, do you want to start the introductions, please?
Yes, Kyle, hi. I'm Adam Silver. I'm from Los Angeles currently, relocated to the East Coast in about a month, not here, a little further south. I run Concierge WP and Kitchen Sink WP, a weekly podcast, and I was freelancing, I still kind of freelance, and I also employ people when I need freelancers. That's me in a nutshell. And I run the WordCamp LA, the lead organizer this year, end of September. You're all welcome, but I'm not going to fly you there.
Thank you. Jen Mears Nickerson out of Marblehead, Mass., and I just rebranded the company from Jen Mears Web Design to Jen's Web, and I've been working as a freelance, mostly WordPress developer and designer for a few years, probably the time flies, and especially having fun, and yes, so I work with a lot of small businesses in the North Shore and try to wrangle everyone through the ins and outs of WordPress, and so far it's been a good learning experience for my clients as well as myself.
My name is Amanda Giles, and I've been freelancing since 2006. I work mostly with small clients, and I also have some agencies that I have recurring relationships with. I run the Seacoast New Hampshire WordPress Meetup, which meets up in Portsmouth, New Hampshire.
Thank you, guys. My name is Kyle Maurer, and I currently work for a plugin company called Easy Digital Downloads. And prior to joining this company, I ran a digital agency for about 5 years. We built WordPress sites for clients, primarily more complex WordPress sites. We really tried to push the limits of what you could do with WordPress. I learned a lot about serving clients, pricing projects, projects gone wrong, how to find them, how to do it wrong, how to learn from your mistakes, and all that stuff. Those are the lessons we're going to try and convey today. I also co-organize a meetup in Jackson, Michigan, and the WordCamps in Jackson and Ann Arbor, Michigan. Ann Arbor is taking place this mid-October. We'd love to see you there. So, the first question that I want to dive into is getting clients. All right, let's talk about this for a little bit, if we can. And let's try and put ourselves in the position of somebody in the early stages of their business. Maybe there are people here who have not been doing this for a long time or not been seeking clients for a long time. Their client base is small, their brand is not well recognized, not a lot of people know that they even offer this service or what they do. How do we find clients in those early stages and clients that will work with us and that we can build a brand on top of? Who has some ideas?
So I've been blessed to not have to look for work for a while, and that's mostly just because I do have a lot of clients. What I recommend, though, I feel like the reason that I have clients is a lot about personal connection. We've all heard when you go for like a job interview, if you know somebody there, having a personal connection with people builds trust. And so if you are looking for clients, I really encourage you to just talk to everybody. You know, talk to that storekeeper whose website was not looking so good. Talk to people you meet. Go to networking events. Go to business-oriented events where you're likely to meet people who are expecting to be solicited for business services. Like I said, particularly networking events. But just don't be afraid to talk to people. I've ended up with so much work just because somebody talked to me, not because they looked at my portfolio, but they talked to me. They said, all right, you seem very nice and honest, and they were willing to take that jump, sometimes without even looking at anybody else, because for a lot of people who are trying to get a website, that whole process is daunting. So to find somebody who is willing to talk to them and engage with them is just, you know, it, like, 90% of the battle there to get the clients.
For me, it's definitely networking. The first thing I did after I started my company, which was started in Salem, was to join the Salem Chamber of Commerce and go to networking events. But then a friend of mine invited me to go to, anyone here has heard of BNI, Business Networking International. A friend of mine invited me to come to that, and that's like a chamber of commerce, but you're the only person who has that profession in the group. So for me to walk into a room full of about 29 to maybe 50 other business owners and be the only web person in the group is very powerful, because they all have questions, they all have their own circle of connections. So I'd say I joined a BNI chapter probably about 8 years ago, stayed with that for a while, built up a good, strong client base. Then I left for a bit, and then I came back when Marblehead had to form their own BNI chapter, and that's really helped drive a lot of business. But you never know. I mean, one of my strongest clients, like someone that hires me as a subcontractor, is actually somebody I used to do babysitting for when I was about 10. So you never know, and it really helps definitely to get your name out there and tell your friends what you do, your family, and always carry your business cards.
I completely disagree, no, I'm kidding. Actually, all true valid points, as well as Meetup. Who here is in a Meetup for WordPress? Who's never heard of Meetup? Okay, so go to meetup.com, type in WordPress in your city or your area or state, and join. It's in the WordPress community, it's free. It should always be free in the WordPress community, because it's kind of frowned upon to charge for meetups. There might be a donation required or requested based on a venue. I run one of the ones in Los Angeles. There's about 12 now. And there's different levels: beginner, advanced, developer, design, business. Find your tribe in that meetup, but WordPress meetups are awesome. Consistently, they happen once a month. How often is yours? Is once a month? Twice a month. You have two to, yeah. So mine's like the third Thursday of the month. So if you're not in a meetup, join Meetup. First, that's how you'll get your name out there. That's how you'll build friendships and relationships. Without that, you don't know. Nobody knows you exist, in a sense. If you're home, working from home, or you have a day job for a while, and you're doing stuff on the side, you need to get out. So BNI. There's also more than one BNI in many cities. So if you can't join the one because they have a web person there, check to see about the other ones, Chamber of Commerce as well.
Yeah, those are really good examples, you guys. Thank you. And I think one of the things that I learned a lot about was that putting yourself in a position where you can demonstrate your abilities, build someone a reputation and your own personal brand, get the spotlight, if you will, shined on you somehow, is kind of helpful. And not all of us are perfectly comfortable with it at all times, but with practice, you know, we can all get good at it, and it does kind of put you on a fast track to increasing your exposure. So even those groups, like those BNI groups, those business networking groups, are really great, because they do a lot to help, you know, rotate the spotlight, make sure everybody gets to, you know, get their message out and explain to everyone what it is they do, what their value proposition is. WordPress meetups are really good for that as well. I can say, all of us here who organize meetups can say without question, finding somebody to stand up and speak on any topic is a chore. It's extremely difficult. So every single month we're like, if anybody wants to speak, just let us know, and we will let you, and we will coach you. We will even help you put together a slide deck if you want to, but nobody wants to. Nobody wants to. Everybody feels that they're not ready yet, they don't have enough information to share, but if you do, if you challenge yourself to put together a deck, to stand up, that even if it's just your small local WordPress meetup, that does a lot for your own personal esteem, and it helps you build and polish your skill set, get that level of comfort speaking in front of people about a topic, and really, really sets you in a place of authority where you're trusted. And that was one of the biggest things a few years into my business that I discovered, that after I had established a reputation, after I put myself in those positions where people could see me speaking and appreciate the experience that I had, they had so much more trust in what I said. Like, implicitly trusted what I said. I had even clients say to me in meetings that we already trust you. We're not looking at someone else. We will go with whatever your recommendation is. And it was that was an incredible moment to feel like just because I built this reputation and this client saw me speaking in front of and a lot of other peers, sitting back and listening, that was enough for them to say, this guy knows what he's talking about. We're not going to question his judgment. That does a lot for your business and for people taking you seriously. The next question that I was really hoping to dive into is something a lot of people struggle with. We always, always are banging our heads against the wall and trying to see what other people do when it comes to pricing. Let's discuss pricing for just a little bit. And I know this is the case for all of us. Your pricing evolves over time. It's something fluid. Your pricing now is not the same as when you started, I'm sure. Let's talk a little bit first about how and why our pricing has changed over the years of serving clients.
I work for free.
I feel like I work for free sometimes. When I started out, I tried to keep my pricing kind of reasonable because it happened right during the housing crisis and people were all feeling, even in like a town like Marblehead or Salem, people were feeling the pinch. So a lot of times, basically what I ran into is people meet me and after 5 minutes of, you know, a few scattered sentences about their project, they're like, what are you gonna charge? And I'm like, well, based on the anticipated, estimated, possible scope of work, here's my price, and it's flexible, and most people understand that. They understand there's contingencies. So if I run into the person that says, oh my gosh, that sounds really expensive, I have to then sort of coach them into like why it's not as cheap as having your quote unquote nephew do the site. So basically I base my pricing on experience and I try to provide a client with a very detailed scope of work so they fully understand why the cost is what it is. Very rarely I found do I actually have a chance to, a real reason to get someone beyond the scope of work. Every once in a while that comes up. So most of the time it's when I get pulled into like a 3-hour conference call that I did not anticipate. And that's when I say, listen, that was a little bit outside the bounds of my anticipated estimate. Is it okay if I send you a progress invoice and I include that? But for the most part, the estimates are fairly accurate, and people like to know up front what they're getting into.
So I think there's a tendency, for background, I build WordPress websites, so I'm a developer. I usually get a design from a designer, and then I'm turning it into something, or sometimes working directly with a client who has an idea. And I think there's a tendency when we're starting as consultants to doubt the value of our own skills, and we're also working tendency to work with smaller clients who also, it's like their own pocket, it's their small business, they're not a big corporation. And so the two of those in tandem means that I think a lot of freelancers when they start out are not getting a very fair wage because they're feeling their own way out as far as what they feel comfortable charging, and they're also working with clients who are very cost conscious. And the biggest thing I can recommend is to understand that that's okay for a bit, but a lot of freelancers have a tendency to stay there too long, to kind of not have confidence in their rates and or not put enough value in what they do. And so what I really encourage you to do is keep track of the time that you're spending on a project and what you're charging and really be looking at that. And use, I tend to use FreshBooks to bill clients, but I also am using it because I track hour by hour what I spend on a project. So when I started, I did a lot of hourly work. Some clients prefer to get a flat rate quote. And the tendency, the danger, of course, with that is that you quote somebody for maybe 20 hours of your time and it took 40 or 60. And if you're not using a project tracking tool, a time tracking tool, you might think in your head, well, it only took me 25. It was fine. And I recommend, you don't necessarily have to use FreshBooks, but use something, even if it's Notepad or Excel, to track your time. Because what you can do is use that to educate yourself later and look back and say, no, you know, I think that was going to take 20, but it really takes 40. Next time I know I need to charge something else. And like Jennifer said, you really need to also not be afraid to go back to your client and say, look, there was some scope creep, or look, this was more complicated. And just have that conversation with them and not be afraid to ask for more money. Or sometimes I'll be like, oh, you only have this amount of money and you want to do this. Well, that's kind of bigger than what you want. What I can offer you is this smaller thing, or I can offer you this at that price, but I'm going to tell you there's a cap on the amount of time I can spend. So there's different strategies that you can take with it, but I highly suggest tracking your time, as it's a measurement that will help you move forward in a reasonable way and not be underbilling yourself forever.
So I don't work for free. First, because of FreshBooks came up, I'll mention it. The creators of FreshBooks have an ebook out there, it's free, about pricing on value. Go download it, read it, it's brilliant. I refer people to it all the time when we're starting out, because there's a future between value and hourly. I do both still, depends on the project. I also charge for scope, for discovery, because I can't take a coffee to pay my bills. It doesn't work. I'll give somebody 5-10 minutes maybe, depends on how the relationship is built, to talk to them on the phone via Skype. If I have to go somewhere and meet you, I'm gonna pay for my time. We're not all there yet, it just takes time. You have to be comfortable doing that. And I started doing that about 2 years ago, after WordCamp San Diego, actually. I was in a track, listening like you were now. And that was my takeaway. From now on, I charge for scope. And if I've done my job right, by listening to your needs, you're gonna hire me. You have a document at the end of the hour and a half talk. I'm gonna write up a document, do the scope, give it to you. I've been paid for my time, flat rate for that scope. And you can go shop it around. But if I've done the job right, I can do the project for what I price it at, which is ideally enough for me to what I want, what I need to do the job, and what somebody else can't compete on, whatever it may be. That said, don't work for free, ever. No. I say that seriously and not jokingly. I mean, you know, if you want to work on spec because you have 4 hours to kill, because you really want to learn something, great. If you want to help a nonprofit, fantastic. But nonprofits have money. Not a ton, some have more, some have less. Even if it's $50, get the $50 up front. You know, because they have skin in the game. You work for free, they don't value your work.
And you make the rest of us look bad.
There's that, right? So, you know, but I do charge, and also, I recently hired someone just last week, because the value was my time versus the work needed. I needed some CSS done, a whole bunch, on a site conversion. WordPress to WordPress, keeping the same theme design, new backend, because the previous developer was a designer, and they did things in a way they didn't know how to fix. It was about 4 years old, permalinks, everything was kind of broken. So we just took their site and updated the theme. Core was version 2.6. Yeah, so there was some technical issues there as well. So they had like 26 plugins. We got rid of most of those. Anyway, I hired someone for 8 hours. They gave me a quote, $30 an hour. Made total sense, use of my time. Hire that person for 30 bucks an hour, 8 hours. Best money I spent. And it was in my budget to outsource that piece versus me taking 20 hours to do it. Could I do it? Yes, I'd be really frustrated. I don't like that minutia sometimes. So don't work for free. That's my takeaway at the moment.
Pricing is a difficult topic to sum up into a short answer like that, and we may have questions on pricing, and that's something that we will probably talk about at greater length. We could talk for the entire day about pricing. There's great podcasts that I listen to. They just do nothing but talk about pricing for consultants like ourselves. It's a big topic. One thing that I think is particularly important, of the many things, is when we're trying to figure out how we should price, it's really important that we reflect a little less on what other people are charging, a little less on what we think clients are willing to pay, or what they expect, or what they want us to charge, and a little more on what we actually need ourselves to continue doing this. Reflect more on that. Make that a bigger factor in your calculation. What do I need to make in order for me to justify continuing to do this, in order to pay my bills and continue justifying this process? That is really the most important thing, which is not emphasized enough in that calculation when I talk to people trying to figure out their pricing. Think more about that. What time do you have in the week to to work billable. What historically have you been able to accomplish, been able to acquire in terms of clients and those projects? I see a lot of people doing very overly optimistic math. You know, I closed this project and I made this much from it, and if I just close 25 more of those, then I'm going to be doing great. But I've never succeeded at that in the past, so this is extremely optimistic. We all, you know, fall victim to that. We all fall victim to saying, you know, if I charge, you know, $50 an hour for my time times 40 hours per week, I'm doing great. That's a pretty nice pay. Except if you're running your own business, you're never going to be billable 40 hours a week. That doesn't happen. So calculate your rate more on like half-time billable. And even if you're doing that, even if your half of your work week is billable, you're doing pretty good. You are doing pretty good. You should pat yourself on the back if you can achieve 20 hours of your 40 as billable during the week, and then set a rate based on what you need. Let's move on to the next real quick topic before we start fielding some questions, because I think there's a few people who have a question ready. The next thing that I wanted to go into was a quick story time. Tell us a project or two, if they're short, that did not go well or as expected, and the one big clear takeaway that you had from that bad experience.
All right, so how do I want to word this? I had a client, hired me to do a site, a law firm, no names, Dewey Scroom and Howe, sorry. Dewey retires, so I'm working with Howe. Howe is my contact. I go meet with Howe, we talk about the project, things are going pretty well. First and foremost, Dewey retires, they want to just update their logo. They contact me. The site is not even WordPress yet. It's a flat site, corporate website, very dry. I go in, I take the file down, I Photoshop it, I put it back up. A couple months go by, then they want to hire me to do the site. I go in and start working on it. And apparently, so Dewey retires. Scroom dies. Yeah. And Hal disappears, in a sense. Goes quiet, goes completely dark for 9 months. Calls me up, says, we're ready. We have the site by Friday? No, you cannot. So what I do now, the story is, because of this law firm, in my contract, I have a dormancy clause. If you go dormant for more than 21 days, three weeks, you know, 21 business days, your project goes on the back burner, restart fee of $250, and a conversation first and foremost, that we may or may not work together to discuss what's going on, what happened. I also, in that clause, in my contract, I also have a conversation clause. I will reply to every email within 48 hours. Well, it has to be both ways. Even if it's, yes, I got your email, let me look into that, if there's a change order someday. But my dormancy clause is solid. You go quiet for 21 days, back burner. I can't wait around. There's other people in line that needs my attention. But that's my story. So if people die. It's awkward. You know, you don't want to be a total inappropriate about it, but you want to protect yourself. You can't finish a project that can be quiet for 9 months.
I haven't had someone die on me. I've inherited a site from someone, unfortunately, passing on. But what did happen to me, it was pretty recent. I had a friend who worked in an SEO company, and he was funneling me, this is through BNI, and he was funneling me a lot of projects. And he's this like total Glengarry Glen Ross sales guy. And he was coming up to me and saying, Jen, this is going to be so cut and dry. This guy owns a cleaning company. It's like 4 or 5 pages. It'll be fine. We'll be done in a week. I'm like, all right. Deposit check. I get in touch with the client. He has no clue about where his domain name is registered. He has no clue about where his site is hosted. He inherited everything from a friend of a friend. This friend of a friend is like someone never answers the phone. So I had to do a lot of detective work for him and a lot of over-the-phone emotional hand-holding because he was freaking out that he couldn't get what I call his intellectual business property, his domain name, He couldn't sort out his hosting. I had to constantly explain to him that domain name registration and hosting are two separate animals in the same circus. So that was something that really just turned. It was supposed to be a simple, and the next time my friend came to me and said, Jen, he started to say, Jen, I got this really simple project. And I was like, it's never simple. And I want to get the domain name registration, the hosting sorted out before I even quote, because that is such a painful process to walk someone through. Long story short, the site did go up and he was really happy with it. And the end result was he was very happy that I stuck with him through everything I worked with him. But that was like, you know, the poster child for the simple site that turns into a nightmare.
I'm hard-pressed at the moment to think of a specific client story from freelancing, but I started a small web development agency a year ago, which is really just like freelancing in a group at this point, because we don't have a lot of overhead. We're all developers, so we're just kind of like a band of freelancers. But one of our very first projects we took on at kind of a low rate. We wanted to take on a big project. It was a big tourism site, and the agency should have been the first red flag if they underbid it because they wanted to get into this market. And we kind of went along agreeing to the underbid. And when I did the final math on the project at the end, it came out to something like $12 an hour for our time. Yeah. And yeah. it was bad compared to our hourly rate in the contract and what we were aiming for. What we discovered from that, though, as a process is part of what went wrong was that there was no project management. The agency didn't know what they were doing. We assumed they were going to project manage us the way other agencies that we had individually worked with were in the habit of doing. And from now on, every project that we take on, we try to establish who is project managing, whether that's internally or externally, and whatever we estimate for time on the project, we add another 10% on top of that for project management. And that's not perfect, but it does help alleviate the issue.
Well, I'm riffing on this question just a little bit. We'll get Matt to go to the first person with a question, if you don't mind. So raise your hand if you want to be the first one with a question. And you want to be second, let's start thinking about your questions. But relating to the project's gone bad, my stories are real short. In succession, I had a client once that totally shocked my business partner at the time and I when we showed up to a meeting that we thought was going to be a fun, productive meeting, and it turned into us just getting chewed out the entire time. We were completely floored, and that was unexpected. Another story, we were building a big website for a pretty big waste management company, and it was an exciting project for us at the time. It was very ambitious, one of the more complicated WordPress sites that we had developed. And we were halfway through the project, very proud of the product that we developed. And we ended up getting fired for the project. And we learned that we had kind of been sabotaged a little bit by someone within the company who had made up some interesting falsehoods about us and about, you know, our intentions and how we were potentially hijacking some things and taking over or putting lock and key over the company assets, all these things that were very untrue. But their word was trusted over ours. And then in another case, we actually had a client pay an invoice, but then put a stop pay on the check and tell us, well, we were off on a business trip. And really the takeaway that all of these and many other stories have in common is communication would have fixed it. The one lesson that I have learned is you cannot update your client too frequently with what you're doing. The common thread between all of these stories is that the client knew very little about what we were doing. We scoped out the project, we agreed on the contract, and we got to work, and that was it. And the client was under some impression that we're not doing anything. They don't know. Clients require constant updates. They're not just going to sit back and trust that you're working. They're going to be questioning whether their investment was worth it this whole time. If they don't hear from you, that's bad. That's really bad. You can't update them too much. So that's one important factor. Over-communicate with your clients. They will continue to love you. They will continue to trust you. Believe that your value is there. So, are we ready for the first question?
I think we are. We got about 10 minutes to take questions, and then anything beyond that, we can handle over there for anyone who's not catching quite delicate.
Thanks, Matt.
Thanks. So, Adam mentioned earlier that you recently hired somebody to upgrade the core and to implement a bunch of plugins. I think probably everybody in here has a need like that at one point or another. I personally have been victimized by people who have hired to do things like that and just disappear or not done very good work or wherever. So I'm wondering, where do you find these people? Where are the best sources to get people who are going to do good work for you?
So the question, okay, so I repeat it, did everyone hear it again? How do we find people? How did I find William to do the? So William actually just did the CSS only. In the case of this project, pretty easy being in air quotes, of course, in WordPress. I did the core update locally. I did the plugins and the theme. Just the migration of content was easy enough to do. I found William in a Facebook. We're friends, actually. He's in the WordPress space. He's a developer as well in San Diego area. I'm in a few Facebook groups, private groups, for certain theme building groups, as well as advanced WordPress developers, etc. He had posted a week earlier that he was looking for work. He was applying for jobs at some agencies, wasn't getting very far, he was kind of getting frustrated. So right away I knew that he was looking for work. And I was on the fence, like, was I going to hire someone for this piece of the project? And I also, at the same time, I reached out, I'm like, hey, what's your skill set in this and in CSS, this theme and CSS? And he wrote back, he was honest. But I know him, that's the key. So I met him through the community at WordCamp, San Diego, WordCamp, Orange County, so yeah, it's based on that. I had two other people gave me quotes, because I posted in one of the private Facebook groups. One was from Ecuador, one was from Canada. Prices were relatively the same, but I didn't know that. So at the end of the day, it's who you know, right? And so since I knew him, it's always a risk. And I have been burned. And I also get tons of calls from other website owners who have been burned from hiring people off of Craigslist. So I am hesitant to say, go to Craigslist, honestly. I get asked a lot, like, I know a lot of people in the community. I've been doing it for a long time. So people come to me for referrals. In this case, I reached out looking for someone specifically. So it's who you know, right? So you have to build that network. You come to meetups, you come to work camps, go to these networking things. So that's, it's always a gamble. Luckily, it's real quick, William did awesome. Really good. I mean, I will bring him on again in a heartbeat. He was awesome. Very happy. I got lucky. I feel it was a good choice.
just to elaborate on that, again, to mention BNI. BNI is a worldwide network, and people are sort of accountable online. So people have reputations to uphold, and I've gotten a lot of work that way through people, you know, going to their BNI networking group and saying, who do you know who has this specialty? And some of them might pop up. They can go on the website themselves and they can research for, you know, with keywords.
Who's got the next question? A lot of hands going up. We're going to try and keep our answers very concise, and if we don't have something to say, we're going to move on.
My question is in regards to time management, like on a weekly, monthly basis. How many projects do you take on per month, do you do monthly charge fees to maintain these websites, and as well as?
So my quick answer on that one is, for my service of Concierge WP, I have monthly packages, yes. And those packages come with certain things, 2 jobs, 4 jobs, 8 jobs. I built that originally for existing clients. Now new people are finding it, so I'm offering some new information there as well. As far as time management, I suck at it.
Triage and the FreshBooks timer, because a big project where I price out a scope of work, I just sort of might send a progress invoice. But also, if someone comes back to me and says, hey, you know, we want to add this page, we want to do this, we want to do that, that's when I start the FreshBooks timer and start the project. And the best thing is that you can directly send them an invoice right off of that timer. It's line item which clients love.
Choosing your pricing model like that, that's really difficult. And a lot of us have iterated on our pricing models over the years. We've experimented with hourly pricing, with project-based pricing, with retainer-based, with value-based pricing, with packages. All of those are viable. And to an extent, it's kind of what you like. Certain client industries will be more receptive to certain models, so you might not, you know, really try and get a pulse for what your typical clients appreciate, and what do they expect? Do they expect a quote for a project? Do they expect to hire someone on an hourly basis to fix their problems in real time? Do they expect to, you know, to have you available during certain periods by package? So understanding who your clients are and what your own personal preferences are. Some people, I know people who just have strong preferences about the kind of the way that they want to work. I want to have one client and they're all I think about for this month. And so I'm going to build my model around that. The only way you can hire me is you buy a month or you buy a week. And that's it, because that's my style. That's my personality. Some people just work that way. So if you have any of those kinds of preferences, you don't want to juggle clients, you know, adjust your pricing model to suit. Or you have a very flexible or volatile lifestyle, you might adjust your pricing model accordingly. These are just some things for you to reflect on, but the end lesson, I think, is that it is largely up to you and what your own personal style is. Next question.
I have a somewhat ethical question. I'm down here. I've been using WooCommerce and I update templates when need be. And after attending some workshops, I'm going to switch to using Hooks because it seems in the long run that'll be a whole lot better and I won't have to worry about keeping my templates up to date. My question is, can I charge my clients for taking this work on myself, the cutting work off in the future, or do I need it?
I'm seeking a little bit of clarification. So are you saying that your work is going to be more efficient now, and so is your pricing less because it's less time? Is that what you're asking?
No, by using Hooks, I'm not going to have to update any templates in the future, I'm going to do some upfront time now to switch over, saving them money in the long run when I have to update templates. But the question is right now, it's probably a learning experience getting into the Hooks. Can I charge the clients for that? Should I jump half price? Should I just eat it myself because I'm learning it and I should have done it the right way initially?
This is a good one. I think I find when I learn something, I definitely just try to keep aware of how long it's taking me. And I think you just have to feel it out. So if you're learning the Hooks, I would look at like how long that's taking you compared to maybe when you used to update the template. And some of the time, I think it's totally fine to charge for. Obviously, if it takes you a really long time to understand it, you have to look at it and make a value judgment, like how much is this skill going to help me later? So I do think you charge for the time, but you just have to balance that out. Not all of it necessarily, unless you're a really quick learner. The other thing to consider is if you're starting to use Hooks, you may be in a position where you should start raising your rates because you're going to start working more efficiently and the clients are going to be getting more efficient code, better to update, you're going to be able to do the updates faster and be providing more value. So it will balance out over time. But at the beginning, I do think there's a little of like, well, it took me 10 hours to figure this out. I'm going to charge them for 5 of that. But you have to feel it out.
The other thing to remember, too, is you're selling your clients peace of mind, and you're also selling them their time back to them. So you can do things like approach clients and say, hey, you know what? Do you guys want to have some peace of mind about your websites and not stress about it? How about paying me a monthly fee? That sort of thing.
All right. Unfortunately, our time is up. I hope this has been valuable to some of you, and I want to emphasize how much all of us, except the one of us who has to catch a flight, are very excited to answer any other questions that you have. So hit us up in the hallway. We're going to be sticking around for a while, and we want to help you. That's why we're here, to help. So enjoy, and thanks for coming to Working at Boston.